just what a Christian thinks.
Yep. Then we go to the third part. Part three. And that is, to what extent are we defined by our educations? And lastly, we have some conclusions. To what extent are we determined by our upbringing, by our education? And we start with, what influence does our upbringing have during our childhood? So not adulthood, our childhood. In general, among children, this influence is very great. A child is still in the process of reactivating all the abilities he had in his previous life as an adult. He does not have them expressed yet. And that process will take some 21 years. For that reason, there is a difference between how children experience influences from their surroundings and how adults experience them. Children have only partially developed their self-consciousness and their independence, and they experience these influences more passively. So they do respond to it, of course, based on their own character, but they have significantly less freedom of choice than when they are adults. And this raises the questions, why did we have the educators we have had? The child's environment, the sphere of thoughts and feelings in which the child grows up, is never, we say, coincidental, as consequently follows from the principle of karma, cause and effect. All processes in nature occur lawfully, being the commensurate results of actions. The fact that we had certain educators during our youth is the result of our own actions and thoughts in the past. We have built the specific character we have today through our own past actions and thoughts, and we were drawn to that family in this incarnation that most resembles us in character. Like attracts like. In this, to us similar environment, we find the impulses and stimuli that can awaken our own dormant, latent character traits. It is a matter of resonance. Our family members and all other people we meet as children, they emit, as it were, their influences, which give our dormant sleeping faculties the impulses necessary to awaken them, to bring them out. And we will vibrate with the specific vibrations those people radiate. So there is no coincidence anywhere. We are drawn to that community, to that thought atmosphere, in which we can optimally become our own selves. There we can learn the evolutionary lessons that we are ready for at that moment. Our educational environment reflects our past thoughts and actions. If we in the past have sown seeds of harmony, we are now reaping them. Or if we have sown in the past, in earlier lives, some strife or discord, or if we have neglected some chance to protect others against wrongdoing, we find ourselves perhaps in a family with full of tension or with troubles. The type of bond we created with other people, the tone and color we gave to that cooperation, to that collaboration, determines the tone and color with which we start the collaboration again in this life. For example, a reincarnating ego may be attracted to a particular family, mainly because there is a social life with many visitors who provide fascinating stories and events. But another ego, another child, may be attracted to that same family because there is an art-loving atmosphere. And so you can also think of many other examples. How free are we as a growing child and then as an adult? The child's free will plays a growing role as he grows up. The growing child expresses more and more free will. His capacity for self-guidance grows with the developing of his potentials. And that self-control, that self-direction, can start very early. Toddlers and preschoolers can certainly already be given a kind of responsibility at their levels. They can already be addressed also on the two sides of their being, their friendly side, their helpful side, and their quick-tempered desire side, for instance. And that they can control the tempered side by simply cooling down for a while and then carrying on. Do we limit the inner development of a young person or not? So this is a question for us as adults. And therefore the question applies to all of us. After all, who among us does not interact sometimes with young people? And as we interact with them, in fact, we can think about this important choice. Do we see a general way of thinking in our society or a general habits in our group as a kind of sacred standard about which the young person is not allowed to think differently, perhaps more deeply, perhaps more broadly? For example, do we see the prevailing scientific theories or our own views as facts that the young person must accept or should accept? Or what we can also do with the young person, investigate those things together. That is a very nice thing to do. And encourage his independent research. We can stimulate his ethical questions and reflections. Even, and sometimes that happens, even if that has consequences too for our own conduct. Because when we talk with a young person about ethical questions and we come to a conclusion together, then that conclusion also should be applied by us, you see? In short, do we limit young people by pushing them into a certain way of thinking or behaving? Or do we encourage their creative, truth-seeking capabilities? And remember, every young person carries with him his own inner, imperishable wisdom baggage of countless lives, and that the child can be wiser than his parents, much wiser than his parents. In fact, that situation happens quite often. So, how free are we as a growing child and then as an adult? And now we come to the adults. Once we become adults, we can fully choose our own path in life. As adults, we can examine the mystical, the mental, and the social views that were taught to us while we were a child. And we can, if needed, revise them partly or revise them entirely. Whatever the experiences during our childhood were, which may range from encouraging, safe place, humane place, to perhaps an intense struggle, or some kind of oppression even, or even traumatic violence, we can exercise our free will as adults because we have the choice. We can learn valuable lessons from our childhood, and we can use them for the benefit of, in fact, our own lives and the benefit of all other people with whom we will live as adults in the future. What is supportive in this connection is the theosophical insight that whatever our past has been, we can build up our future through our present choices, by the process of cause and effect. The nature of our current thoughts will be the nature of our future environment. Example, surgeon. We read about an American surgeon who, as a black boy, grew up, in his case, in a poor and even violent neighborhood. He was, alas, drawn into a kind of struggle for existence on the streets. And at one moment, he, in a rage, tried to kill another boy with a knife. However, that knife bounced off at the medallion that that other boy was wearing on his chest. That event came to him as a deep inner shock, as a wake-up call. He didn't want to live that way. In fact, he was thinking of the wounded people he had seen. Then he saw, hey, I want to assist those people and if possible to heal those people. And he actually worked on and on and on until he was a surgeon. That is an example of what you can do with your adult possibilities. Now this comes. Raising young people is in fact one of the most beautiful, also responsible tasks. Guiding young people, raising children, is one of the most versatile and also responsible tasks we humans have. It is very versatile because it covers all aspects of life. You may say the mystical aspect, the mental aspect and the social aspect. And remember, our own example, what we radiate towards others, we talked about the sphere by the questions. Our own thinking and life always makes the deepest impression on a child, because that determines the tone and color of his living, of her living environment. It determines the mystical and mental and social force field in which that child grows up. So are we determined by our upbringing? No. We determined our educators ourselves in the past. All the people who presently influence our lives or did influence our lives are the results of bonds that we forged in the past, and we can learn from it. But we can determine our future parents and educators through our thinking now. Who our educators, mentors, role models will be in our lives to come will be determined by the type of thoughts we are thinking now, the character of our present thoughts. Because our character determines which people we will be attracted to later. So we end part 3 with this inspiring idea. Without exception, selfless and understanding people always pop up in society, formally or informally. This popping up does not need to happen by formal positions, such as becoming an administrator or a judge or a scientist who is famous, although that may be possible. Remember, a person like Mahatma Gandhi had no formal power at all in India. Yet, those people will always radiate their spiritual encouraging influence because they cooperate with the essence of nature. They are in alignment with the fundamental harmony in the universe. And remember too, all reform movements that fought for improvements, mystical improvements, mental, social, or fought for independent thinking, they all started as a small group of dedicated people. And anyone who develops his inspiration, even if it is only a glimpse, even if it is only now and then, will, without exception, be an example at that moment for his fellow men, even if you do not always see the external effects. So, you see, the effect of the thoughts that you radiate are always there. So we come to our conclusions of the whole lecture. Our free will is fundamental. Not even the most powerful being can take it away from us. our free will is as free or unfree as we make it ourselves. We expand our free will by identifying with that part of us that looks through all personal illusions and thinks compassionately. Third conclusion, we can remain ourselves in every situation and act with insight. We achieve this by keeping our communication line open to our conscience and universal visions. We can always choose whether we want to be a core member, co-worker, or a guest in a particular group. We can do this deliberately based on our best insight into what we can do for humanity. And the last one, the environment in which we grew up, gave us the stimuli to awaken our own characteristics. And we can learn very valuable lessons from our upbringing. Okay, people, this was part 3 of the lecture. And again, you can submit your questions. And after 3 minutes, we will be there again. Until then. Yeah. Hello again. And Mariska?
Yeah, at this moment, we have one question.
One question.
You told that you radiate your thoughts and create a sphere.
Yeah.
Is it then okay to say that you better not join a group when you are sad or angry or tired, because you might affect that group negatively?
Okay, yeah. Very logical question. True. Yeah. Yeah. Well, I think it depends a lot on the exact what group and what situation and what moment, but the possibility is there. Yeah, this is also a kind of choice. Yeah, there is but let us say to look to a few possibilities when the group is, for instance, a team which has to really to do some task which they have to accomplish. Then you usually say, I try to focus on the task. I try to forget my sadness and some other problems which I carry with me. Sometimes it will, you are much more successful in forgetting it than other times, of course. But sometimes it is simple your duty. So you stay and you do your best. So that is a very situation where you would really stay, yeah. And there are perhaps some other possibilities. For instance, when the group is more not a working group, but a situation where you, for instance, eat with each other and have some relaxation time. Now, then you can beforehand you can ask yourself, okay, is this the moment I can perhaps also simply really talk about the problem of me? Because you must always remember that it is not so that we have always to solve our problems ourselves alone. Yeah. So the group members have also, of course, should also be in the possibility to give a good idea to us, etc. Because you are all helping each other. So, and then you can try to find out some insights from other people to solve a problem which you have in yourself or which you find in the world. Yeah, so it is also a possibility, and there may also, of course, a possibility that it is a situation with a group which is in a certain way totally not necessary, but okay, but perhaps nice. And you say, no, I want to use my time or energy or my concentration in a completely other way. I do not join the group. Yeah. And I think that may also be a very good choice sometimes.
Yeah. So again, always your own responsibility to think it over and see what you're going to do.
Yeah, sure. But the fact that you ask the question is a very important one. Mm. Because then you see responsibility. Yeah. Yeah. So it also means that you can, for instance, you can, when you have to join a group and you have also some emotional little bit frictions with it, you can prepare yourselves for it by focusing on, you may say, the important things you can bereiken,
create reach
by being in that group. So I once heard of someone who, there was a kind of standard feast, which a person was not so feast-like, and they said, okay, then I must join the feast. But then he changed thoughts. He found a way beforehand, before he went to it. He think, there are some people who, for me, are, I think, very interesting to talk with. Or I have still a question for that woman, and I still have a very good reaction on for that man. And so that person created a kind of ideas of, I can do something very good. So he did not move in the group like a slave, but he went to those persons. He had very good talks with them. And, well, he went back to the after that evening in a very nice mood. So in that way, you can also have the lead.
In the meantime, there's another question. Is it true that when you put good intentions at the forefront, your old habits also increase in strength? So you need your willpower to learn to control those old habits.
Yeah, true. That's a good remark. Yeah. It is theosophically true, and also, you may say factually true, because you can investigate it, that at the moment that you really try to reform some motives or some goals in yourself, and then at the same moment, all thought patterns that beforehand you did not see because they fitted you, you were content with it, it was okay, you didn't find them bad or something like that. But okay, now you have another goal, a higher goal, and at that moment, those old habits are sometimes not fully anymore so what you want. So, in fact, what you are going to do is to re-research, in fact, all your old habits. And that can sometimes be in a very, that can sometimes have a kind of strong reaction, yes, true. It may even so appear as something coming from outside. Very strange, but very true. That we have always the example of someone who say, I stop stealing. And just one day after, someone else is just leave some luggage behind, and so you walk around, and then you fall for the uitdaging, the challenge van, hey, do I keep now on my promise, yes or no? And that really often happens. So that is not coincidence. It is something seemingly coming from outside, but it is you yourself who makes you to make that inner step, which only becomes a real step if you act like it. Then it becomes a real step. Before that, it's only a fake ideal. So good question.
Well, thank you, Henk. These were the questions.
Very well. Then we make close. And we do that to say that about next week on March 10th, we will have our study meeting about this subject, how free are we? We hope to see you then again, and that you'll join us. But now you have to register. Perhaps you already know, which can be done at our website. And we come now to the end of the lecture with the very ancient text from the Rig Veda, and it's about the path to our inner possibilities, our inner wisdom, and here is the text. O thou golden sun of most excellent splendor, illumine our hearts and fill our minds so that we, recognizing our oneness with the divinity, which is the heart of the universe, may see the pathway before our feet and tread it to those distant goals of perfection, stimulated by thine own radiant light.